Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
It's wonderful to have so many people gathered for our celebration today. I wrote in our As We Gather a little introduction to start our service. It says, "The family of Berea has been truly blessed through the years. While nothing in our ministry has come easy, as it never does in this life, God has strengthened us, guided us, equipped us, and continually sees us through 50 years of pressing forward in faith and trust. All the while, we have been inviting others to join us here now and for eternity with Jesus. We have been entrusted of pointing people to Jesus and His love, and the family of Berea has done that faithfully, joyously, and continually. So we celebrate today, thanking God for the past, asking Him to continue to equip us for the future. We begin our worship with the singing of our opening hymn. Please rise.
Christ, have
your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Strengthen our fellowship in the bonds of love and peace, and increase our faithful witness to your salvation. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
As we join together on this joyful day in God's house, we hear his word written for us in the Old Testament in the book of 1 Kings, the 8th chapter. The lessons are printed for you in the order of worship. Then Solomon stood before the altar of the Lord in the presence of all the assembly of Israel and spread out his hands toward them and said, O Lord, God of Israel, there is no God like you, in heaven above or on earth beneath, keeping covenant and showing steadfast love to your servants who walk before you and with all their heart. You have kept your servant David, my father, what you have declared to him. You spoke with your mouth and with your hand have fulfilled in that day. Now therefore, O Lord God of Israel, keep for your servant David my father what you have promised him, saying, you shall not lack a man to sit before me on the throne of Israel, if only your sins take close attention to their way, to walk before me as you have walked before me. Now therefore, O God of Israel, let your word be confirmed, which you have spoken to your servant David, my father. But will God indeed dwell on the earth, beneath heaven and the highest heaven, and cannot contain you, how much less this house that I have built? You have regard for the prayer of your servant, and before you this day, that your eyes may be opened night and day toward this house, the place of which you have said, my name shall be there, that you may listen to the prayer that your servant offers toward this place, and listen to the plea of your servant and of your people Israel when they pray toward this place, and listen in heaven. your dwelling place, and when you hear, forgive. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson this day from Paul's letter to the church at Ephesus in the fourth chapter. God's word says, there is one body and one spirit. Just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. One God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore it says, when he ascended on high, he led a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. In saying he ascended, what does it mean that he had to also descend into the lower regions, the earth? He who descended is the one who also ascended before and above all the heavens, that he might fulfill all things. And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds and teachers to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the same stature of the fullness of the Christ, so that we may no longer be children tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every word of doctrine, by human understanding and cunning, by craftiness and deceitful schemes. Rather, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up into every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined together by every joint with which it is equipped, with each part is working properly, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel for this day.
Not quite yet. Sorry.
The choir is going to stand up.
Thank you.
do people light a lamp and put it under a bushel basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house? In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We remain standing as we make the common confession and profession of our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of His Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father.
Thank you.
our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
It is with a feeling of great joy and thanksgiving that we gather this day. Over the past 50 years, there were times that many wondered if you would get to this day. I'm sure some of you wondered if you'd make it to this day. Such it is in life, especially for the people of God. Oftentimes, it seems that circumstances are against us. Everyone is against us. The world is against us. And sometimes, we're even against ourselves. Oftentimes, just like the children of Israel, we are faced with what seems like insurmountable enemies oppressing us, or a big watery obstacle ahead of us. And in typical human fashion, we think, what can we do to make it better? What can we do to make it work? What can we do to fix the problem? And like the children of Israel, we need to be reminded and learn who it is alone that can protect and sustain and bring us to the promised land. Like God's people of old, we need to hear and take to heart his proverbs. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make straight your paths. When our Lord stood before Pontius Pilate, Pilate asked him, "What is truth?" Jesus could have pointed to himself and said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." The truth was standing right in front of him, and Pilate could not recognize it. Hearing that verse from Proverbs, we could well ask, what is trust? Whom do you trust? Why do you trust them? Now, typically, we expect people to earn our trust by what they do for us, by how they honor what they say they'll do for us. Then there's always the question about how far should I trust them? And then once that trust is broken, how hard it is to restore. See, for us, trust revolves around us. We make the judgment call as to who and how far we will trust. It's about us. And we base our actions and the directions we take on how we can trust someone else. Think of a young couple standing before the Lord, pledging to love, honor, and cherish in sickness and in health, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer. If the bride doesn't trust the groom, she will not enter into that marriage, but if she trusts him, she will. Even though she has no idea how worse or poor or sick a future they may have, she trusts that they will see it through together. So she embarks on this new life with a heart full of joy and love and anticipation. And as time goes on, they celebrate one anniversary after another, and as they do, they reflect on the past, considering the present, anticipating the future. In many ways, the celebration of a congregation is not that different. 50 years ago, the people of God embarked on a new journey. What would the future hold? Were they full of hope and joyful expectation? No doubt they were. But like that young bride, who could say the next 50 years would bring? Smooth sailing or rough waves? Safe ports or rocky shore? Calm skies or swirling tornado? Better or worse? Richer or poorer? Sickness or health? When a congregation is started, there are so many unknowns. There are many things that will affect the life of that congregation as it travels into the future. But the people of God embark on that new path just as the children of Israel embark on theirs. And we journey as they journey, trusting that the Lord God Almighty will sustain, support, and guide us. But we also remember that the children of Israel were a fickle bunch. Just a few hours out of Egypt, and the sight of the waves of the Red Sea overshadowed the suffering they endured in Egypt, and they forgot how they had cried out to the Lord for deliverance, how he heard and delivered. Long gone was the soft thought and sight of the plague that he brought upon the Egyptians. That was so sweet. But now look where we are.
behind us. They looked behind them, and they looked at their current state, and they looked ahead at the waves, and they blamed God and Moses. They regretted the action they had taken to lead. They regretted trusting the Lord and his servant. I wonder if there were some in that great crowd of people who were problem solvers. You know the type. Some who assess the situation and then lay out the plan. Maybe we can reason with the Egyptians. Maybe we can form a human chain across the sea. Maybe we can just hide. But none of that would work. As they looked behind and ahead, they despaired in their present. But as is so often the case with the people of God in this broken, sin-filled world, they were looking in the wrong direction. Help was not behind them, nor was deliverance ahead, nor was the answer within them. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. They needed to raise their eyes above. They needed to, again, trust him who alone could support, sustain, and deliver them. I'm sure you've heard it said, when times get tough, the tough get going. Again, that's the looking in the wrong direction. When times get tough, trust in the Lord with all of your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. The children of Israel needed to be reminded of that again and again and again on their journey to the promised land, and so do we. When times get tough in the life of the congregation, look up. Look to the Lord of the church, for he alone has the power and the will to sustain his people and his church unto the promised land. And he does it as he has for generations, through his word and sacraments. That's why he moved his people some 50 years ago to start Berea, so his people would have a place to gather, that he might feed and nourish their souls to sustain them through the wilderness journey of this life into the promised land of our father's mansion. And so over those years, as he fed and nourished his people, his love stirred their hearts to reach out with his love to others, to reach out caring for the spiritual life of those around you, and to reach out and care for the physical needs as you raise. See, the Lord gathers his people in a congregation around his word and sacraments to strengthen and sustain them, to forgive and deliver them, to make them prepared not just for the journey to the promised land, but also fit and forgiven, redeemed and restored for that day when he will take his people through the gates of heaven. And in doing so, his love moves them to love others, to tell everyone what he has done, to tell how he gave his life for your salvation, and how that precious gift is for them as well. What mercy and grace the Lord bestowed upon his people here. To have a place to gather in his holy house and receive through word and sacrament his divine blessings. And so our trust is firmly planted in him who gave us life, who gave us new life through water and the word, who gives us eternal life through his death. When we kneel before his cross in repentance, our trust is in his word. Your sins are forgiven. When we open our bowels and receive his body and blood, our trust is in his word, given and shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. When we face approaching enemies or seemingly impassable obstacles before us, our trust is in his word, lo, I am with you always. As you face the next 50 hours or 50 years, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not lean for God is faithful. Trust him. What he has promised, he has done. What he has promised, he does. What he has promised, he will do. He will make your path straight. That doesn't mean everything will be smooth sailing in your life or in the life of the congregation, but it does mean, as he has promised, that he will work all things for your good. He will guide and sustain you on this journey to the promised land. He has only the best in mind for you. His desire is salvation for you, and he gave his lifeblood to bestow it upon you. Nothing, no one, no obstacle you may face here is more powerful. powerful than the Lord Christ and his love for you, as he has promised in his holy word. What shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all of these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. In him is our trust, even when we don't understand why we're going through what we're going through. We trust him who has given us a place to gather, that he may feed and nourish our souls. We trust him who created, preserves, and saves us. In all our ways, we acknowledge his love for us in Christ Jesus, and we eagerly look to the promised land he has prepared for us. The Lord Christ preserve you and his congregation. Peace of God which passes all understanding. Keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus and through our Lord.
Amen.
At this time, the offering will be brought forward, and it's our practice that as it's being brought forward, we will sing the offertory prayer. We were able to purchase our building and our property here to continue ministry. And so we wanted to take a moment to recognize that through a retirement of the mortgage. So as it says in your bulletin, dear brothers and sisters in Christ, it is with joy and gratitude that we officially celebrate the retirement of the mortgage for Berea by the Water Lutheran Church building and property. In thanksgiving, to God we rise for prayer. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank you for having guided us and given us the courage to press on. Thank you for working through your church and its individual members to provide the resources needed to fulfilling the purchasing of our building and property to continue ministry in Goderich. With gratitude, we remember our past and look forward to the future. Continue to grant us unity of family, purity of intentions, and the goal of nurturing your people in faith through word and sacrament for the salvation of the world. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
One of my congregation members, while we were at the Synod Convention a few weeks ago, had mentioned to me that we haven't sung the Common Doxology for quite some time. It's fitting that we do so now. We'll join our voices. As we prepare to celebrate the Lord's Supper, hear Luther's admonition. I exhort you in Christ that you give attention to the testament of Christ in true faith. And above all, take to heart the words with which Christ presents his body and blood to us for forgiveness. That you take note and give thanks for the boundless love that he showed us when he saved us from the wrath of God, sin, death, and hell by his blood. And that you then externally receive the bread and wine that is his body and blood as a guarantee and pledge. Let us then in his name, according to his command, and with his own words, administer and receive the testament.
Welcome to the Lord's table.
Lord, Savior Jesus Christ, given unto death for the forgiveness of all.
great treasure now we find fulfilled at last. Those whom Jesus called apostles journeyed with him side by side, heard his teaching, felt his power, saw the way he lived and died. Then the news of resurrection they delivered far and wide. Through the intervening ages,
round the world the gospel spread.
Thank you.
May this holy and precious body and blood of our Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you in the true faith to life everlasting. Be part in his peace.
Amen.
Please rise for our post-communion prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, you have given us a foretaste of the feast to come and the Holy Supper of your Son's body and blood. Keep us firm in the true faith throughout our days of pilgrimage, that on the day of his coming we may, together with all your saints, celebrate the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Definitely an encouraging thing. For those that aren't aware, we do great here at Berea. We average anywhere from 16 to 23 on a Sunday, but to have over 100 to fill the pews and have them chairs in the back and it not be a funeral is even better, right? And so it really is. It's an uplifting day. Our people, our family here at Berea has been so excited and building up. Unfortunately, a couple of our key members weren't able to be here. They are on a cruise right now, and it figures that right at the end, they were supposed to be back Wednesday, but right at the end of the cruise, they caught COVID. So they weren't allowed to get on an airplane or anything, so they were quite upset that they couldn't be here. But they are a pivotal part of our family here, and so we do miss them today. But we are live streaming the service, so I know they're watching. Matt has Wi-Fi, so they said they'd watch it, so that's good. But again, it is so wondrous to have all of you here. Our family here was so excited that they just wanted to enjoy the day that for the meal we're having afterwards, you know, typically we do potlucks and so forth, and they said, no. Have it catered and have somebody come and set it all up and have it prepared. Because they just wanted to enjoy the time with all of you. And so I'm really, again, the spirit here, the attitude here, the joy that's here It really is overwhelming. We are a small congregation, no doubt about it. But again, everybody is pulling together, supporting each other. So I can't say enough about our congregation and our family here at Berea. I do want to make some acknowledgments concerning that. If I'm not mistaken, and don't be offended if I am, I believe that for sure two of our founding members are here, and that would be Shirley Keller was one of them, and I think Eleanor was a founding member as well, weren't you, Eleanor? So Eleanor Crawford and Shirley Keller, and I think, and who else? June. Oh my goodness, what am I thinking? Oh, and I got some others here. Look at this. And so we got June over here. She comes quite regularly, faithfully, still part of the family here, and it's great to have her. So we have three of our, and then you guys as well. See, I didn't know that. So there you go. So five of our founding members 50 years ago here today. That's a wondrous thing, too, that you guys could be here. And again, you probably have your stories. I know Shirley every once in a while tells me little bits and pieces, but you guys probably all have your stories of the ups and downs. And I know Eleanor has shared with me through the years that when Berea first founded, it was just a general expectation that they're not going to last long here. And that it was just because this was a highly Roman Catholic area, so that was a big stumbling block. But it was expected that, they were going to struggle and maybe you weren't going to make it. But here we are 50 years later, and we are still going strong. Even small, we're still going strong. So, again, thank you, those who are the founding members, for seeing that vision and enabling us to keep going on to this day. I am excited that Eleanor and Shirley and June and you guys were able to be here today. Unfortunately, I got a phone call this past week, or even a text, actually, this past week. Pastor Bars, the first pastor here, he was going to be here, but unfortunately, our wonderful border has issues with passports and so forth, and he wasn't able to get his all secured in time. But we do have a video from him, and so him and his son put it together, so Hannah's going to play that for us.
Greetings and God's blessings to all who are celebrating 50 years of ministry in Goderich, Ontario. I had hoped to join Noah in this joyous celebration, but delays in getting my passport renewed has made it impossible for me to be there in person. I hope that this method of bringing greetings and a few memories of my time in Goderich will be helpful to know that my thoughts and my heart are with you. My time in the prettiest town in Canada for 8.5 years, beginning in June 1974, included challenges as well as some of the highlights of my ministry. Some highlights are being installed as the first pastor of the new Berea by the Water Lutheran Church on August 31st, 1975. Another is the dedication of the House of Worship on June 2nd, 1977. Assuring the community that we were here to stay. Another highlight is Vacation Bible School, held at first at St. Mary's Catholic School. Marilyn would write in her book, Six and a Bonus, we established a good reputation in the community through our VBS programs, which was a key part of our gospel outreach. A great highlight was seeing the renewed faith and commitment of people reached through our evangelism visits. Another comment from Marilyn's book, a new congregation is much like a new baby. It needs to be fed, nurtured, and trained to grow up. Finally, I rejoice on this day to quote the Apostle John, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. God's blessings on this day and on the future.
Yeah, that was awesome. That was amazing he was able to do that. Now, not only do I want to recognize Pastor Bars, Pastor Wayne Dyke is also here today. He's the predecessor who came before me. That was 20 years ago.
Yes.
Yeah. So who would have thought? But yes, Pastor Wayne says it's great. He's retired now. But it's wonderful that he's able to be with us today, him and his wife, Pat. I think she's in the choir back there.
Yep,
there she is. And so it's great to have you with us as well. You played a pivotal part in all those years of your service here. So again, I want to thank you for your service. Our Stratford Circuit guys, Pastor Bublitz, he is our district, or our regional pastor, former district president, our regional pastor. But he's also one of our Stratford Circuit guys. So it's good to have our Stratford Circuit men with us. Unfortunately, Pastor Bill Nye was going to be with us in Diane, but he had to take his wife to emergency last night. She's home now, but he did have to take her away in the morning. So he sends his greetings and encouragement, but he just wasn't able to be here today like he had planned. One of the final things I have is our another Stratford Circuit pastor. He is now our Synod President, Reverend Timothy Toysher. He wrote a little note. It says, "Dear members of Berea by the Water Lutheran Church, praise God from whom all blessings flow. It is with those words from the Common Doxology that on behalf of the congregations, pastors, and deacons of Lutheran Church Canada, I greet you on the occasion of the 50th anniversary of the founding of your congregation. I think especially of those who were born again as children of God at the baptismal font in your church, or the couples whose sacred union as husband and wife was solemnized before your altar, or the mourners who were comforted by the word of God and prayer at the funeral of loved ones, or the great number of people who received the gifts that Christ won for us on the cross and at the empty tomb. The gifts of forgiveness and life and salvation. Through the hearing of his word and the partaking of the holy sacrament of his body and blood that was proclaimed and administered to you by the various pastors who have served you over these past 50 years. As you mark this milestone in the history of your congregation and look ahead to whatever number of years the Lord has in store for your congregation, I would share with you these words from Martin Luther. God help us as he has helped our ancestors and will also help our descendants to the praise and honor of his divine name throughout eternity. For we are, after all, not the sort of people who could sustain the church, nor were our forefathers, nor will our descendants be such. But the Lord has done it. It is doing it now and will do it. For he has promised, I am with you until the end of the world." In Christ's service, Reverend Timothy Toysher. One of the words that stuck out for me when Pastor Bars did the video was, he said that by establishing the congregation here in Goderich, we were letting the community know that we were here to stay. That was a big motivation whenever we were trying to finance and try to figure out how we were going to be able to keep this congregation so we can have this presence, so we can have this footprint in Goderich. Again, thanks to many of you, we have achieved that with your assistance. And the congregation, the family that gathers here, they are so thankful and they're looking forward to the future. They're looking forward to what's been entrusted to us, not just by God, the ministry that he's given, that he's entrusted to us, but also the fact that all of you have supported us and you've entrusted to us this ministry. And we are rising up to that and we will continue to do that. So I want to thank all of you for your support, your encouragement. We desperately always need your prayers, so keep us in them. I'm just going to, John, was there anything that you wanted to say? I know, it's a last spur of the moment. I know, you're going to love that. Was there anything? John Shelby's our chairperson. He was leading us through this time of the purchasing and so forth, and he was pivotal in making it all come into place. Is anything? Sorry.
Well, I guess when we started off with this endeavor to see if we could purchase the church, we weren't sure whether we would make it all. So it was overwhelming.
again, we have a wonderful family, wonderful leadership here in this congregation. There is absolutely no way I could do any of this without the support and encouragement of all the leadership, all the congregation members here. So I do thank God for all of you as well as the congregation and for our ongoing ministry that we have here. So I do want to acknowledge that. And I want us to now, is there anything else that needs to be shared? I saw you had your hand up here for a sec. Go ahead. I don't want to keep
I just want to say, you know the expression, what goes around comes around. My name is Glenn Ringer, and I was my wife Isabel, one of the founding members and charter members of the congregation. But when Pastor Barth mentioned the difficulties of coming across the border, what goes around comes around, he had problems getting across the border the first time. Isabel and myself and we're attending Shirley Keller's place, waiting and waiting and waiting for them, and finally we got notification they weren't going to be there that night. However, the furniture was here in the truck, and the truck driver wanted someone to sign for this furniture. Not knowing of ours at all, we agreed that I would put my name on this furniture, and so it was here. However, the next day it got resolved, and they got here, and they were our pastor for many years.
I hope that, go ahead. It is extremely warm in here, at least I'm extremely warm, and so I know there's ice cold water in the other room. So I want to encourage everybody, there is tons of food. Pauline has prepared a wonderful meal for us. I encourage all of you to stay for our time of fellowship, for the meal if you can, and then we can share our stories, we can share those different things, and just enjoy one another's company. Is there anything else? The announcements are in the bulletin, that little yellow sheet for the Zion and Berea family. You can see all the things coming up. Hannah, I should ask, anything you need about BTS that you want to mention or anything? It's in the bulletin. Perfect. Go ahead. If there's nothing else, yes. Absolutely. Should we acknowledge that as well? All right. We definitely. Bill has been our organist for a number of years now. That, as a matter of fact, Pat was organist whenever I took over and she was leaving. You were playing, I think, right then. And then I know Dale, he's here somewhere. Dale's back there. He played at one point. Kathy Potter, I didn't see her today. So Kathy was our organist, and then Bill's now our current organist. And isn't it neat to have a young guy playing the organ? Right? I'm not mistaken, I think the organist at Moncton's like 92 years old or something like that. So to have somebody so young and play, and I won't say Joanne, how old you are. But Joanne's been playing since Helen, that was, you were quite young, right? 1981. So Joanne's been our organist at Dashwood. So we've been blessed at both congregations with wonderful organists. So thank you, Bill, as well. Yes. If nothing else, go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks.